you, Charlie. Appreciate that. Well, you know, they say things come in threes. Let's hope the three is that we've already had the three snows in the last week or so. Otherwise, we may be looking at, we had snow last Sunday, snow this Sunday. We may be looking at snow next Sunday, if not. So, in fact, one time they were, had several people tell me back before me, or I guess, I don't know how long ago, but they said they had snows, really big snows, every Wednesday for like a month. Do y'all remember that? I was not around at that time, so. But they every Wednesday. So let's hope this isn't a pattern we're starting to do every Sundays instead of every Wednesday.
That's when you have to go to Saturday school.
Do what?
That's when you have to go to Saturday.
That's when you had Saturday school. Yeah, I could see that if you had were out Wednesday, Thursday. It probably took 2 or 3 days to be out.
We had Saturday school in May.
Oh, in May. Not real fun, was it? No.
Snow happened in 1960.
Do what?
1960 was every Wednesday.
It was out 1960? That was...
You think I can remember that, didn't you?
Yeah. That's a good memory. That's a good... You got a good memory, Billy. You got a good memory. That's awesome. Well, let's hope it's the three that we've already just had. That's, maybe that would be the threes. For today at 2 o'clock, the scavenger hunt. So if you would like to participate in that, join at the sanctuary side of Main Street at 2 o'clock. And you'll be able to do with the youth and the children and stuff for scavenger hunt. So that sounds exciting. Also, next Sunday is Valentine's Day. If you would like to bring some, very simple, just like when we were young and little, not way back in 60, but you know, when we were young and in the elementary school. you know, when you just brought little simple little Valentines, you know, and stuff that we can pass around and share around. And if you don't want to do that, that's fine too. You're welcome to bring little Valentines and maybe perk up somebody on Valentine's Day next Sunday. And with that, I believe we are ready to sing the first hymn, Blessed Jesus, at Thy Word. And Charlie is really getting us to know some new hymns. So, thank you for that, Charlie. But Blessed Jesus, at Thy Word. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you.
At this time, we'll have our prayer time. You'll have the prayer list in front of you and the bulletin there. Are there other prayer concerns that we want to lift up this morning? Well, hearing none, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And I believe the school is starting back up in person, not this Monday, but the next Monday on the 15th. So we definitely need to be thinking of all those going back to the in-person and stuff and things. So especially that. So let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you so much for your many blessings. We thank you for all that you have done for us. Lord, you've blessed us in so many ways. You have been by our sides every step of the way through 2020, which was just an amazing year, a year that caught everybody off guard. But Lord, you were right beside us. You were with us every step of the way. You helped to lead us and to guide us, and you were there to give us strength and encouragement. And for that, Lord, we say thank you. And we also thank you that we can look with hope to new and exciting things in this year of 2021. That we can look to exciting opportunities to gather together and to be blessed by you. And Lord, as we look forward, we thank you that we can look forward with you beside us, knowing that you will always be right beside us, sometimes even carrying us. But for that, Lord, we say thank you. And we lift up each of the prayer concerns that are on the prayer list. Lord, we lift up the schools and as they go back to in person. Lord, be with each one of us in the concerns of our hearts. And just allow us to be reminded that you are a God of hope, a God of healing, and a God that takes care of us when we need it most. And for that, we thank you, Lord. And now, as a people of God, we gather together to pray as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We do want to thank everyone for all the wonderful times that you have so faithfully given your offerings, whether it's by sending in the check for those that are home, for those that are here, in whatever way that you have continued to faithfully give, we thank you for that. It's what a blessing that has been to us, and we know that God is going to use those gifts in wonderful, wonderful ways. And we know of a way soon and shortly that will be able to be used for help and things that you will hear about at a later date. But we just praise God that he has been faithful, and we praise God that you all have been so faithful. So we praise the Lord for that. And at this time, we have someone who has faithfully been practicing and is ready to give us special music. Thank you. The scripture passage this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Matthew, the 5th chapter, as we continue on from last week, starting with verse 13. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trodden underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid, nor do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Think not that I have come to abolish the law and for the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Whoever then relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But he who does them and teaches them shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you so much for your many blessings. We thank you for all that you do for us. Lord, I thank you that you have given us this, your word, to inspire us, to encourage us, to help us. Lord, help us to see you in this and also to see ourselves. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. There was a little boy that grew up way down in the south part of Texas. And when he was about 10, his family had been had moved from Ohio, but they had never been gone back up there. And so there was a death in the family, so they went back up to Ohio. And that night after they got there, that next morning it started to snow, and it started to snow really big and heavy like sometimes it does in Ohio. And all of a sudden the little boy looks out and he's so excited, and everyone thought, you know, he's going to want to come in and run and sled and stuff, but he just came in so excited. He said, I can't believe it. I've never seen so many grits in my life. There's grits everywhere. Well, you know, there's often times that we see something and then it's not exactly what we thought it was. Sometimes when we take a passage of scripture and we don't look at the context of it, sometimes it's not exactly what it looks like or can be if we're not taking it in context. And this passage that we see this morning is clearly in context with who Jesus was speaking with in the first 12 verses of this chapter. And do you remember who they were? Who was the people that Jesus was specifically lifting out, specifically talking to? It was those of the multitude that was there that had done good works in their life, but had not really been appreciated by the world or by others. They were the ones that Jesus had picked out and lifted up and said, blessed are you, you're a peacemaker, you're pure in heart, you're merciful, you're kind, you have a right spirit, you're pure in heart. Jesus was lifting out and talking to all those who had done good works. And now Jesus is continuing that same thing. He's still talking to the same ones. He's still talking to the ones who do good works in their life. And I know he's also talking to you and to me, because we have done good works. When you look around, you can probably name a lot of the good works that each and every one of us sitting here have done. And when you look around at those that and see those that are at home and stuff, we can also see the same thing from those who are watching virtually and stuff. We can look around and see that we are a church that has done good works, done good things. So let's look and see how Jesus responds to those who he has just lifted up and said, you are blessed. You are happy. You have the joy of God with you. So now let's look and see what else Jesus says to those who are kind and merciful, peacemakers, pure of heart. He says, you are the salt of the earth. Now, he's not talking to every Christian. He's not talking to everybody, every Jewish person. He's not talking to everyone, the whole multitude there. Remember, he specifically picked out certain ones, the peacemakers, the pure in heart, the kind, the merciful, the righteous. He picked out certain ones to lift up, and he was saying, you are the salt of the earth. And he also said, you are the light of the world. Two wonderful things that happen. You are the salt of the earth and you are the light of the world. What does that mean? What it means, Jesus is saying, is you have a purpose in life. You, by the fact that you're doing good works, by the fact that you are a good person and you're doing the things of God, God created you and you have a purpose in life. You are here for a reason. There is a reason you are here. Salt has a reason. There is a reason that God created salt. There is a reason that God created light. There is a purpose that each one has. Salt, there is a reason for it to be. It has a purpose that God has given it. Light, there is a reason that it is here. And there's a reason and a purpose for it. And what Jesus is saying, you are like salt. You are like light. You have a purpose in life. You are needed. You are needed. Wow. I don't know about you, but that makes me realize how blessed I am to know that God says that when we are doing good things, when we are living the life with Jesus and with God and trying to do our best and trying to do the things, that God has said we have a purpose. He has created us for a reason. We're not just here just to kind of, well, you know, I've had some people say, well, we just live so many years and then we die. That's it. You know, it doesn't really matter what we do or, you know, where we work or where we live. We just exist for a while and then we die. Jesus is pointing out very clearly, just like salt has a reason to exist, just like light has a reason to exist, you and I have a reason to exist. God created us to have a purpose, and you and I have a purpose in life. And that purpose is to do what? Well, Jesus exemplified that when he says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So there's two things that we are created for, that God has given to us as our purpose of life. One is to do the good works, the very good works that he had just earlier lifted up for the people for having done. Being a peacemaker, being a pure in heart, being kind, being merciful, being loving. Those who are doing good works, Jesus says, let other people see your good works. That's part of the reason why you have been created, why God has chosen you to be a part of this family of God. You have a purpose in your life. You have a reason to exist. God has created within you the ability to show others what can happen when we do follow God and when we are a part of something greater than ourselves, the family of God. And when we do good works, others will see that. They will see it just as clearly as they will know when salt is good and when salt has lost its flavor. They will know it just as surely as when there's darkness and a light comes in to shine away the darkness. It will be that clear how God will use us to show others of his love, his joy, and his forgiveness of who God is, because they will see God in you. You have a purpose in this life, and that's to show others that God exists, that God is alive, that God is real. And it will show forth just as clearly as salt and light. And Jesus also said, not only do we have a purpose in life, not only do we have a reason to exist, not only are, you know, we do that to show people our good works and to give glory to God, to prove that God exists. And when we give glory to God, we're just letting people know that God really is alive and He really does exist. He really is a part of my life and He can be a part of your life. But Jesus also then went on to say this. Think not that I have come to abolish the law of the prophets, but I have come not to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass away from the law until all is accomplished. What Jesus is saying is, I have a purpose in life as well. And when you follow me, you will be following with me in the purpose that God has given to me, that my Father has given me to do and to accomplish in this life. My purpose is not to be negative, not to abolish things, because that's exactly what Jesus was being accused of. The scribes and the Pharisees were saying, oh, don't listen to this man. He just wants to tear everything down. He just wants to tear down all the prophets, all the laws, everything, that all the traditions. He just wants to tear all that down. They were trying to point out that Jesus was negative on what Jesus was doing. But Jesus was saying, I have not come to abolish. I have not come to be negative and to tear things down. I've come to live, to fulfill, to embolden and to help you live and to fulfill your purpose in life. And that's exactly what he was saying. I have come to fulfill and to live out my purpose for God. But I've also come to help you live out your purpose for God. To give you strength. To point out the fact that you're doing good works. You're doing good things. And God appreciates that. The Father loves that in you. You see, Jesus did not come to abolish or to destroy. Jesus came not to be negative, but Jesus came to be positive and to fulfill his life and to fulfill his purpose and to help you and to me fulfill our purposes. You know, sometimes we may think, oh, I don't have a purpose. Who am I in this whole world? Who am I? What kind of purpose would I have? What would it really matter if I wasn't here? But what Jesus is saying, I'm sure there was a lot of people that he was talking to in the multitudes that had that same thought. What does it matter that I am here? And Jesus said to them, and he says to you and me, just like salt matters and has a purpose, just like light matters and has a purpose, you matter. You matter and you have a purpose. And part of that, if you follow me, you will see that I am fulfilling my purpose. But you will also notice that I will be helping you to be the salt and the light that you have been asked to be and created to be by God. To think that we have a purpose. We're not all of a sudden God says, oops, where did that person come from? You know, that must be a mistake. I don't know anything about it. God had a purpose for each and every one of us when we were born. He created us. He lovingly molded us just the way he wanted us, for the purpose to do good works, good things in this world, and for the purpose to bring glory to God, to let people know that God is real, God is alive, and God loves you. God has a purpose and a plan for our lives. And that, brothers and sisters, will enable us to be the best salt and the best light that we can be. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our next hymn, O Church of God United. Let's stand as we sing, O Church of God. Lord, may our faithful service and singleness of aim proclaim to all the power of thy redeeming name. When we do good works, Jesus, reaffirm to us that it will proclaim to all. It will be a light to all. It will be salt to all. We will be proclaiming the power of God's redeeming name and his power in our hearts and lives. When we do the good works, we will know. We won't have to wonder, does anybody notice? Does anybody care? We will know that the one who created us notices and God cares about every good work.